This is the Hour of Awesome with Robert, Chris, and Steven. This isn't the hour of neat, cool, or rad. It is all going to be awesome.
Okay, this is the Hour of Awesome, episode 16, the Keanu Reeves episode.
Whoa.
And with me tonight, we've got Chris Culp.
I know Kempo.
Okay, and Stephen Humphrey.
Are you sure? I don't know. You were pausing.
Actually,
there.
He does know Kempo, man.
Well, that part I recognize. No, I wasn't questioning Chris and his capabilities. But I imagine it's whether or not you actually know that I'm actually here. But, you know, go with you on. That was a good reaction, though, Robert. I like the video. This is the important part, to be able to sit and watch you react in some sort of way.
And eventually walk away.
Yes. You should definitely get up and walk away.
So this is our first live episode, and you see me staring over to the side. It's because I'm looking at our YouTube stream, which looks to be delayed about 30 seconds.
I think it's about right, yeah.
Yeah. And we have zero people in the chat at the moment.
Well, yeah. I'm shocked.
If you don't tell anybody that you're going live, it probably limits their ability to know that you're going live. If we had invited, you know, Mr. Reeves, Keanu, I refer to him, he might have shown up to it. But since we didn't invite him, he can't participate.
Yeah, well, I don't think he's good. Great. Now my mic is not recording. I'm having no end of technical difficulties today.
That sounds terrible.
It was going to suck.
Well done, sir.
Yeah. So, yeah.
It sounds terrible.
Today's all Keanu all the time. Again, I've lost my intermediary bumper. So which inappropriate bumper will I play today?
Probably Keanu themed.
No. That would be too appropriate. Let's go with this one.
I'm American, honey. Our names don't mean shit.
There we go. I have no idea what that's from.
It's probably Bruce Willis to me.
Previous award winner. But
something from our Bruce episode.
So for our first clip, we have this.
Bill, what? Strange things are afoot at the Circle K.
So our first film that we're going to talk about is kind of the quintessential film for talking about just turned 50, Keanu.
Well, that's the part that throws me. Before we even talk about Bill and Ted, we have to talk about, you know, our connection. Well, we got to talk about our connection to Sir Ted Theodore Logan, as it were. I don't think he's made a level of knightness yet. I think that is reserved for the English and so forth, the faux Scottish and the like. But, you know, this is the interesting thing. So he turned 50 on September 2nd, so very recently, right? Yep. This is an experience. He sort of went through that. He looks like he's 30, 35, and he's been around roughly forever in my world as you know, even he's even older than Robert, which is pretty impressive since Robert's older than dirt. there's that line.
Yeah, but you know, 50's the new 30, so that's why it looks like he's 35. You know, and then 30's the new 15, so you know.
So
yeah, that explains Steven's behavior.
Fair enough. No, I'm okay with that. That's good.
Mine's more like 12. But
yeah, well, we'll go down that path.
Penis.
But if you take with Keanu, I'm gonna keep us focused despite Chris.
No, you're not.
Yes, I am.
You'll try.
So, Keanu was around for a while before he jumped into our consciousness. Yeah, I'm gonna go with that. That sounds pretty pretentious, right? Yeah. In terms of Bill and Ted. Bill and Ted was actually like 90 or 89.
Yeah.
And so he'd already made...
1990 when he entered the Zendrol zeitgeist of our film viewing audience. But no.
Zeitgeist? What the hell's that?
It's German. It means car or drive, doesn't it? Didn't I learn that from the commercials? Everything means car.
To which I say,
whoa.
Yeah, you gotta be quicker on the trigger on that one, man.
Yeah.
Whoa.
All right.
It's got a slight delay. I gotta push it before I want it.
Anticipatory.
That's what she says. Oh, I'm sorry.
We've lost any semblance of capability today.
Yeah, he's channeling Beavis and Butthead.
Oh, man. No, see, I always connect Keanu to sort of childhood. And yet,
he Cartman,
has been a part of this. I'm going to just ignore you all today, Robert. I may just cut out your audio and it'll work out much better. Because since you're not recording your own audio, this will be a good choice for the podcast.
I am, but I got to put a serious compressor on it because it keeps spiking.
All right. Well, we can't really hear you very well because it's kind of a loud over something or other. So good job.
What, is it screwed up again?
Oh, you sound terrible. But it could just be you.
Do I actually sound terrible or are you just giving me crap?
You don't sound great.
Yeah, it's not so hot.
Yeah.
Damn it. Okay, keep going. I'll see if I can figure out what's wrong.
So Bill and Ted. There's a Bill S. Preston Esquire and Ted Theodore Logan, and they went back through time after meeting the immortal George Carlin. Good run. Good fun film. Ridiculous in every way. You have Socrates. You had enjoyable peace with him. He was a great philosopher. You had Billy the Kid for some reason, even though I think you should have brought out Emilio Estevez at that time since he was just having done Young Guns.
That would have been awesome. And Lou Diamond Phillips.
For some reason?
Yeah, because why not?
Oh, man.
He's the greatest narrator ever.
Well, there you go. My favorite recent anecdote was that Samuel L. Jackson tried to walk onto the set of Breaking Bad and just sit on the set as Nick Fury. Eating chicken. That's the same thing. I don't know why we don't do more of that in films where people just sort of wander into the films, you know, as other characters just hanging around, uncredited. You know, it's the George Clooney as the dog that barked on a South Park movie. You know, that experience. Are we restarting the whole show, Robert?
It's the evening of technical difficulties on my end.
I really just want to put a big red X over your face in the show now, but...
I packed everything, then I unpacked it, and now it's all jury-rigged together, and I don't know what's going on.
Fair enough.
I'm supposed to be in a different house.
Okay, we did that episode, though.
Yes. It's a very long episode that I'm rather sick of.
Anyway, yeah. There was a film. So anybody want to comment on it? About? Bill and or Ted?
Ah.
Bill, who was, of course, in that vampire film, which was fantastic.
Oh, my God. That was horrible. It's Dracula.
No. That was Ted.
Bill and Ted? No, Ted was in, yeah. Keanu Reeves was in Dracula.
Right. No, Bill was in the one with Kiefer Sutherland.
Oh, Lost Boys?
Yes. Okay. That was fantastic. That's the only other part I can come up with Bill. I honestly don't really know anything else that Bill has done, though they are still trying to make another film of this.
Yeah, I think just directing is all he does.
That's great, but if they can make a Bill and Ted number 3, that would be awesome. Like, pretend that Bill, that 2 didn't happen or something, that they didn't actually play the guitar. It would have been wonderful.
Oh, God, that was awful.
They have grandkids now.
Yeah, maybe they're actually play.
I like the idea that they came up with a band that saved the world, right? Like world peace and harmony, all because of Wild Stallions. That's
We are Wild Stallions.
I like how Ted, they were always threatening to send Ted to military school.
Yep.
You know, the whole time, and his dad had married someone Ted's age and kept calling her Missy. But
no, it was mom. Bill did that. Bill did that.
Oh, that was Bill. That's right. That's
hey, Bill, remember when you asked Missy to the prom? Bill,
that's right.
Yes,
that's right. So yeah, it was a great movie. I remember seeing it. This is what stands out in my memory about Bill and Ted. When I was a kid, I was looking at the cardboard cutout thing they had in the movie theater, and it had an advertisement of Bill and Ted, and everybody packed in the phone booth, right? Because that was the time machine in the phone booth. Yeah. It's Socrates and Napoleon and all these people in it, right? And The text on top said, "The world is about to be saved by two kids that can't even read," or something like that, right? And so I was laughing at it. My mom was like, "That's terrible that they're making heroes out of people that can't read. You know, that's not something to be proud of." And that's my big memory.
That's a good marketing plan.
Yeah, you know, and I ended up seeing it in the theater anyway. I guess I would have been 13.
All right.
12 or 13. Yeah.
It was a experience. 13, yeah.
That would mean I was, oh my God, I was that old and seeing that film? Never mind.
So,
I could have been 12 because, you know, I have a late birthday in the year. So, I could have been 12.
But so, Robert, you know, you're a Southern California guy for a while, for a period of time, or at least California guy for a period of time. This is your area. I recognize it was not the same time.
San Dimas?
San Dimas was somewhat in the area.
Okay.
Did you have a connection from that? I recognize that you moved off and you were to the wet area.
Yeah. I moved to Washington State 20 years before the film was made. So... Yeah, that was never the Vol Valley Girl thing when I was down there. Nobody was going, dude, that was not the whole surfer culture. That became later.
Okay.
Yeah. So I got to wander off and turn on lights, apparently.
Okay, so this will be the part of the show where Robert walks away.
The part or just one part of the show? This is intermission number one for Robert.
The first time Robert walks away.
So all the things that we need to talk about Robert...
Bill and Ted, I think it's actually a pretty good movie, to be quite honest.
Oh, it's really watchable.
Yeah, it's,
I'm so looking forward to having some control over my life.
It's one of those movies that, you know, if you can sit down and watch, have fun, and not feel bad about it. Like, it's not like, oh, I can't believe I sat through and watched that,
right?
Even though it's completely stupid.
Oh, who cares?
You know, it's an absolutely stupid movie,
but in a brilliant way,
right? Not like in a wanted dead or alive way.
Correct.
It's quotable. It's fun. It's stupid. It's, you know, just, the, you know, you have the very 80s aspect of it. Again, I recognize it's the tail end of the 80s, but it's when the tail end of the 80s is when they really started to capture the 80s-ness as opposed to when they were living the 80s-ness. This is the reproduction of the 80s-ness. So that's why when you wander off to the mall, you know, they're playing terrible stuff while doing aerobics with Joan of Arc, you know, and was it Genghis Khan got into a aluminum baseball bat? And it's just the feel of it got very, very 80s.
Oh, yeah. Very 80s mall culture. I mean,
yeah
in that scene for sure. Yeah. Because all of us that grew up in the 80s hung out at malls like that.
Yes.
You know, probably, the one that I hung out wasn't that nice. But,
well, you know. Yeah. But it's still, I mean, now, today, you wouldn't have the connection to a mall if it was a place that if you, you know, your parents return your clothes or something, you know, that's the extent to which you do anything there.
Yeah, you don't see a lot of teenage kids hanging out the mall anymore. Maybe it's just the mall near my house. I don't know, but you don't see that as a thing.
I don't really look to figure out where the teenage kids are hanging out. I mean, I don't know what you're into, but it's not my thing.
Yeah, I was told by the court to stop doing that.
Oh, okay, fair enough.
Sorry, Chris's mom. Sorry, Chris.
And your wife and your...
I don't know. I think the last show only had five. I think the last show only had five views, so I don't know if we can even count. I think my mom's given up on us at this point.
Yeah, fair enough. Really selling it, man. There you go. I don't know. Okay. We're moving on, I guess.
We can do anything you want. It's so out of control at this point. But I don't care.
All right, hit something. Silence. Hit a button.
Yeah, that's good. So, for my part, I picked two films. One was Point Break.
Pause. Wait.
And it's making more noise.
Like in Utah, they knew that they were paying a federal agent to surf and pick up girls.
Babes.
Big one.
The correct term is babes, sir.
So, I liked Point Break. It's a really crap film.
No.
But I had so much
fun. How is it
it's
crap?
It's not a good film.
It's fantastic.
It's not a good film.
Look, if you're going to have a conversation about Keanu Reeves, and I think we are trying to, despite any effort to do the otherwise, his films are, if they're not, I mean, the basis of it is that he picks fun roles. He picks films that you can pick up and watch and have fun with. He doesn't do a lot of deep thought, you know, let's get into some sort of revisitation of, you know, culture, some whatever dolly kind of thing or something. I mean, the idea of it is to have a lot of fun, and
actually,
that is
yeah, he does.
Let's say the Matrix, even the Man of Tai Chi was kind of like that.
He did. He takes himself extremely seriously. So, what? Can you not hear me?
I'm just ignore you.
Is this thing on?
The answer is no. No, it is not. Probably yell at the mic a little bit to see what if it works for you.
Yeah.
The solution to everything is to be louder.
Sorry, Johnny. Looks like you don't get to be president.
Deep.
Anyway, yeah. So I thought Point Break was a fun but not good film. I had a lot of fun with it. So I really liked this film. I liked that going back and looking at it, he looks like he's 12 years old, which is just astounding. He was really young looking for a really long time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I'm guessing he's the illegitimate child of Dick Clark.
Okay.
So I think that's the solution. Because, you know, Dick Clark seemed to not age for 60 years.
Yeah. I mean, he was in that film, he was only 27 or something like that. So, I mean, he was young. I mean, it wasn't like he was old. He was playing somebody who was supposed to be 25, 26, 27. So he was actually almost age appropriate, too.
Yeah, but the best actor in the film? Gary Busey.
Oh, I was going to say Patrick Swayze, but okay.
Yeah, I mean... Tank Girl was decent too, but okay.
He's the president of the dance.
Yep.
Nobody. Okay.
Yeah. No.
You've never heard Patrick Swayze referred to as president of the dance?
No.
Oh. No. Did you ever see The River Dance? He's the lord of the dance. So.
No.
I've
seen okay. Roadhouse.
Yeah. I mean, we can have a whole conversation about Swayze if you want.
I like Roadhouse. So I think that's a very undervalued film.
It's a fantastic film.
Yeah.
But so nonetheless, this
second man has a PhD.
I like Gary Busey's Amazon commercial recently. A lot of people didn't like it, but I thought it was funny. Like, I like talking to things. Hello, pants.
So was this before or after his motorcycle accident?
Keanu?
No, Gary. No.
Break.
I don't remember.
I don't know.
See, bad accident, smashed his head open.
Yeah.
Then got a little different after that.
Yeah. I don't remember exactly where that was.
But anyway, I thought he was fantastic. I think he really added to the film by just being him. He's just a weird dude. Different style. It played off well against the young punk, you know, Keanu. Yeah, and then Patrick Swayze. I've always liked him. Yeah. You know, a lot of people slam his films and his acting and stuff, but I thought he was great.
Well, he was near perfect for that role.
True surfer dude.
Yeah.
I thought he embodied that persona really well. I bought him way more than I bought Keanu as an FBI agent.
The only thing I remember for the film.
I am an FBI agent. Yeah.
That and cool. We're supposed to believe he... And this will come up again in Steven's film, that he's supposed to be this grand college quarterback athlete. Why is he always, I don't know, something about him that casting agents go, yeah, football?
Sure, why not?
What, because he skinny and runs funny?
Okay. Costner did, two or three... sports films, you know, certain people get into that kind of experience, you know, if they're into that, whatever. Yeah.
I think the Replacements, though, was only his only sports movie, right?
Who?
Keanu.
Well, he played football in Point Break.
Well, he has that baseball movie where he, the one where he's supposed to be the thug and he becomes the coach of the kids' baseball team and it turns his life around thing. I don't know. It was horrid.
Hardball?
I think I've seen it.
Hardball.
Hardball, yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I didn't see it.
Yeah. I think I've seen most of his films, except for 47 Ronin. Other than that, I think I've seen them all. So
Man of Tai Chi?
Yes, I saw that. Okay. I watched that actually last week. So I could talk about it this time around.
There you go.
Well, let me get on to the most superior of his films, which would be.
I want room service.
Johnny Mnemonic. Which has Dolph Lundgren as the preacher.
Yep.
So, a very undervalued performance.
At least it didn't have Rutger Hauer in it, but ignoring that.
Actually, I think Rutger Hauer would have been perfect for that film. They had Rollins, man. Actually, he was probably the best actor in the film.
Henry Rollins is awesome.
He was really very good.
Yeah. He's good at everything.
Yeah, but I think this leads nicely into Chris's film, because in this one, he hacks his own brain.
Yeah.
You know, using really crappy virtual reality gloves and a dolphin and some various other crap. It's a fantastic book, but wow, they just blow it in so many ways in this film.
Who wrote the book?
It's William Gibson.
William Gibson. Yeah.
Cyberpunk stuff, yeah.
So the Lord of cyberspace.
I mean, nobody's ever figured out how to translate any of his stuff. Or actually, if you think about it more broadly, nobody's figured out how to translate that whole genre.
Yeah.
I mean, The Matrix was the closest thing, and that was its own.
I think it's the only one.
Yeah.
The rest are always, they're usually, calling them B films, I think, is elevating them. So, like, C film.
I don't even know if I would call The Matrix cyberpunk.
No, but at least it.
It's close. In the genre.
Yeah, it's ballpark, I guess.
It's along the lines of, like, The Net.
Yeah.
That was fantastic.
You can order a pizza on the internet.
Yeah.
Or think about Mission Impossible, where Tom Cruise went onto the various web pages, I guess, to go to the Bible pages and enter notes on to Job 3:16 or whatever he was doing
to communicate. I don't know what that was supposed to be. Some kind of weird IRC.
Good. Let me hop on Gopher.
I haven't even thought about that in like a decade.
I'm going to tell that in the Gopher.
Yeah. And then we'll use Dogpile. Alta Vista.
Well, you have to dial up on Prodigy or CompuServe first, but.
Oh, yeah. Genie, baby.
Yeah, but where in 1995 could you order a pizza online?
Nowhere.
Maybe you probably could find one or two places in California or something that would be into it.
Yeah, maybe.
Oh, jeez.
There was a guy who bought, you know, a pizza with Bitcoin, you know, 5 years ago or 7 years ago or some stupid thing, like right at when it was introduced. And that Bitcoin today, if you still had it, was worth, you know, $50,000 or something stupid.
Yeah,
you know,
tomorrow it's worth 20 cents.
So. Well, yeah, but it's more to the point of there are always somebody who will, like, oh, we have a new technology, let's go and, you know, have the three people who know how to use it, you know, have access to it.
Yeah.
Well, I'm actually in the midst of re-listening to a book called Fool's Run. It's by John Sanford, I think.
Sanford and Son?
And I'm really enjoying it because it's mid-80s era. Talking about
set in a junkyard.
Shut up, dummy.
The big one!
What was her name? I'm coming to you.
Oh, I don't remember.
Damn it, what was her name?
Martha or something, but...
Yeah. Oh, God. Red Fox was brilliant.
Yeah, he was.
Anyway, Fool's Run is it's an 80s era book on hacking, and hearing them talk about, you know, and he got out his K-Pro and these kinds of things, and old dial-up stuff, and they're going to hack a thing in DC, so they have to find a place that's in the same area code to be doing the dial-up hacking from. It's just a wonderful blast from the past that really made me wish that Johnny Mnemonic hadn't been made. Just thinking, oh man, it's so bad. They're always so bad. Why can't they do a decent film on this crap?
War Games
was okay. Yeah, except you can't hack a phone by, you know, taking a coin and diddling the thing. Yeah, none of that was right, but still. I completely lost my train of thought.
Manhattan Project.
Dolph Lundgren was awesome in that film. I think that's his best role next to Rocky IV.
I will break you.
Yes. And it's about the same level of dialogue. I think
that's his only line in Rocky IV, actually.
I will break you.
Okay, now go punch that. Okay.
Yeah. Can you believe that guy's got like a master's degree in chemical engineering or something?
Sure.
Does he really? Like they say that in The Replacements, but I didn't think that was true. Like I thought this was part of the character.
Yeah, no, the guy's supposedly very highly educated. So, but he's got this great line in Johnny Mnemonic when he yells, "Halt, sinners!" And he's just fantastic as the preacher. It's the only character that I felt really kind of came to life in that film. Rollins was great, but Rollins was being Rollins.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. He just delivers lines very well. So, yeah. And then I think the one line I played, the "I want room service," is the only memorable line from the film. Do you remember any, Steven?
No. I've moved on to the history of Dolph Lundgren.
Okay.
He dated Grace Jones. He is a third Dan black belt in Kyokushin Karate and competed in it. He was European champion in 1980 and 1981. He completed his master's degree in chemical engineering from the University of Sydney in 1982. He's a hell of a lot smarter and more interesting than the rest of us.
Okay.
I don't know. I've got a PhD in physics and a black belt in Kenpo.
Okay, well, you're more interesting than us. Okay. Yes, but were you in Masters of the Universe? No.
No,
you were not.
I wasn't. No. I was as a child, I mean, in my mind, like all the time.
He-Man!
Yeah.
Oh, God. Yeah. Okay.
The times I dated Tila was, oh, boy, I couldn't tell you.
Chris?
Yeah?
You're on.
All right. No, it's not my turn.
It is now.
Oh, I'm getting skipped tonight.
I know kung fu.
Okay, go ahead.
All right. So I was responsible for two movies. And The Matrix and The Man of Tai Chi. I'll start with The Man of Tai Chi. You guys told me that was going to be bad. I kind of liked it.
Yes, but do you like terrible films?
Well, yeah, but it's not that bad. And it's actually, from what I understand...
Hey, put it on the scale, man. Give us the scale. Better than, worse than.
Oh, it's better than Maximum Overdrive.
Okay, so it's
clearly
a two?
Better than One or Dead Alive. Was that better than what?
Is it a two on a scale of watchable to want to kill myself?
No, I'd give it a solid 7.
Oh, God.
It's not that terrible. Yeah, it's really not that bad. I mean, it's his directorial debut, apparently, and it's a bilingual film, so some of it's in Chinese, some of it's in English, so you know, be prepared for subtitles, because it's actually in Chinese, but the parts are in Chinese. And it's about a guy who is training at this Tai Chi temple, and he competes in martial arts tournaments in China. And that's, you know, set in China there. And then he meets Keanu Reeves' character, who he actually plays the bad guy in this film. He's sort of the CEO of this company who holds these underground street fighting tournaments where people die in them. So they're illegal, you know, these illegal tournaments. And so Keanu Reeves sort of rigs things up so that this kid's temple will be condemned if they don't raise a lot of money in a short period of time. And then all of a sudden, you know, Keanu Reeves is able to offer a job to this kid and say, hey, you know, you can make a lot of money, you know, working security for me. And security means it turns out it's fighting. And the kid sort of gets hooked on sort of the evil ways of the fighting circuit, has a falling out with his Tai Chi master. Then he sees the error in his ways and, you know, his friends again with the Tai Chi master and kills Keanu Reeves' character.
Spoiler.
Well, you're watching this movie and you're not going to be surprised by any of that, okay? Because you've seen this movie 100 times in terms of the storyline. So I'm sorry if I spoiled it for someone, but you haven't been paying attention to the 1,000 movies you've seen previously, if I have surprised you with the outcome of this movie. All right. It was totally watchable. I had a good time. My wife was away on business last week, and I said, I'm going to watch this movie and check it out, and it was good. I recommend it.
So I have to ask this question. The character Galang Sanjaya, who we're supposed to fight in the death match, do you ever see him fight that guy?
I have no idea who that is.
Okay, well, it says, I'm looking at this, at the information about it, say, in the death match, Tiger was a face Galang Sanjaya, now fully awakened to his reality. However, Tiger refused to fight, but challenged Anaka for a match instead. The reason why I ask is Galang Sanjaya is played by Iko Uwais, who starred in The Raid and its sequel, which The Raid Redemption is a fantastic film.
Oh, that
film.
Is that guy.
Yeah.
I haven't seen it.
Okay, that one's fantastic.
It's a hell of a lot of fun. You'd enjoy that one, Chris.
It's
a video game in movie form.
Yeah.
I know this guy. I know who this is now. The Salat Fighter. Yeah, he this is the guy I'm thinking of. Let me see his picture real quick. Yeah, he has a part at the very end where he's supposed to fight him to the death at the very end of the movie, and then basically what happens is there's a police raid, breaks up the fight, and in fact the guy that plays Tiger was hesitant to fight the guy. This is like when he had his turn, you know, in his like turn of character or whatever, and
he'll turn is he in WWE
something like that, and so he doesn't end up fighting the guy, but what was I gonna say? I don't remember.
You're gonna say
So anyway, I totally lost my point there.
So did he ever fight him is my question?
No, I mean, he dances around the ring with him a little bit.
Okay, so this is more to the point of, I was curious because he is a really interesting martial arts fighter. And so I would just love to have seen that thing, and it would draw me or into the film more. It's more to the point.
Yeah, there's not too much of his martial arts there. Now, from what I understand, the movie is very, very loosely based on this guy Tiger, who I think Keanu Reeves had worked with as a stunts or something along those lines. I'm sure it's very, very loosely related. But yeah, it's on Netflix. If you already have Netflix, go check it out. Because it doesn't cost anything.
Yeah. And again, the Rotten Tomatoes puts it at 71%. This wasn't the film that we were telling you stay far, far away from it. We're telling you about 47 Ronin is the one that you'd be more apt to be scared of. But
no, I watched that. That was fine. It is what it is.
Okay.
Yeah. It wasn't terrible, but it wasn't great either. Very predictable movie. You knew it was going to happen.
Yep.
Special effects were cool.
That can people go watch Transformer movies. So clearly they don't care about plot.
Better than the Transformer movies, I thought.
And you've sat through all of them.
All of them, every last one of them,
including the old '80s cartoon version.
Yep.
And I actually like that.
The third one was particularly terrible, but the '80s cartoon version was cool because Optimus Prime said "damn." That was awesome. It's awesome when you're five watching that.
Whoa.
Yeah. So.
Keanu Reeves.
Yeah. The other movie I saw, of course, was The Matrix, which is the movie everybody knows.
Yes.
I think it's from 97?
99.
And it's a story about a hacker who gets to see the hidden reality of the world, which is a fake world set up by computers.
Blue pill.
That's right. Set up by computers to keep humans imprisoned as battery power for their machines.
Now, as a physicist, do you buy into that?
Yeah, right.
Yeah,
now,
sure.
I was on Point Break saying I didn't think it was a well-done film, but I really enjoyed it. The Matrix, I think, is a beautifully shot film.
Yes. Yeah.
I mean, just watching the film, it's really pretty.
Mm-hmm. And the story is cool, too. I mean, I enjoyed the story of it. You have this guy who is supposed to be the one, the guy that will save humanity.
Neo? The one?
The one. I know.
Amazing. What was the chances that they could just turn Neo into...
I had a friend... I had a friend whose last name was Anderson in grad school, so we would always call him Mr. Anderson. Yeah.
You're an elf.
Yeah, well, now, if you haven't seen it, you got to go see the Honest Trailers version of The Matrix.
Oh, I haven't seen it. I should check that out.
Oh, it's fantastic, especially when it gets into all the homoerotic undertones of the film between Neo and Morpheus. It is just, the subtext. Nailed it.
I'm going to go so far as to say that I didn't think the other two were horrible either. they were fine. No. Not as good as the first one.
No.
You were watching Rubber again, weren't you?
What is so bad about the other two movies?
They're completely unwatchable. They're terrible. They completely ditched the whole concept of the previous film.
Yeah, but you can't get hung up on that.
CGI. How about that?
What was that, Robert?
The world's worst CGI.
Oh, it wasn't that bad for the time.
Yeah, I don't care about that aspect of it. I more had an issue with the fact that you built up the first film that he could, you know, basically bend spoons and the like. I mean, he could do whatever he wanted. And then the next two films, he just sort of wandered around. It was like, I don't know if I can do. What can I do? What's happening? What skills do I have? Am I really the one? What are we going to happen? Yeah, let's go party.
This has happened before. It will happen again.
Who is that guy over there? And then there's a virus. And there's a virus now? Why is there a virus? And this guy drinks wine. And what are we doing? Yeah. It was so disappointing.
So, but I think the thing with the, what was it? The architect? That whole bit just killed it for me. Yeah, and the bad excuse for the have to be attacked in the real world and everybody's all moody and we have to replace all our actors and come up with new sweaty people.
Well, that was part of it was just the we had one person die off. We had people that didn't want to negotiate with, so they had to replace the characters. And it was there was a lot of those just sort of like, oh, and let's do all the same things again. I now know Kung Fu again. Oh, interesting. I can fly a new vehicle. Ooh.
Yeah, now certainly the first one was better than was the best, no doubt. But I thought the other two were fine. Like, you know, not as good, but they're watchable, as far as I'm concerned.
I feel like if you had had somebody who just sort of looked over their shoulders and say, by the way, not working, why don't you focus, you know, and do something else, it could have come out very well.
Well, it could have come out a lot better.
What was that, Robert?
They started taking themselves way too serious.
Yeah. Yeah, it could have come out a lot. It could have been a lot better, no doubt, no doubt. But like I said, I'm fine with what it is. I mean, in terms of it's okay. It could have been great, but it turned out to be okay. So those were my two movies, The Matrix, Man of Tai Chi. Everyone's seen The Matrix. If you haven't seen The Man of Tai Chi, it's fun. Go watch it. Good time.
Whoa.
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 Well, okay. Replacements.
The Replacements. Hey, we're The Replacements.
Hey, I've now we're The Replacements. This film four times.
Four times?
Four times. Wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty high,
it's
man.
It's one of those ones that comes up on, you know, like free Showtime, free HBO a lot.
Yeah.
And for some reason, it'll come on and I just let it run. And I don't know why, because it's not like it's Groundhog Day or, you know, one of those films where you go, oh, cool, it's on. It's like, yes, The Replacements, woo! No, it's just like, oh.
Heart.
For some reason, I will be mesmerized by this. Maybe there's some kind of subliminal programming in the film. You must watch bad football movie.
Miles and miles of heart.
Yeah, that's what it is. Yeah, okay.
Whoa.
No, it was an obvious film, right? I mean, it is the... You know, the guys who didn't make it anywhere, the as I said, the never were, you know, the guys who end up stepping in. It had a lot of those, you know, undertones of these guys don't really appreciate what they've got and all that stuff. And I'll ignore that aspect of stuff because I find that to be kind of BS. But the idea, whatever. It's like, oh, those rich football players, you know, they don't understand. It should be the money's really about the getting to the owners, not to the players or whatever it was. But it really was a situation of, again, we had some odd characters, and that was the point, right? You could have people who couldn't cut it in the NFL for whatever reason, and maybe it was because, you know, Keanu's character completely blew up the same knee or whatever in that movie, because he was playing at Ohio State. He was an Ohio State football player in both films. You recognize that. He blew out his knee in both films.
Oh, my God.
It was the same character. He says he was working on the boats, you know, getting rid of barnacles or whatever, but really he was working in the FBI in California until he came back.
Should have linked those more closely together. That would have been awesome.
Let's do a bridge movie that connects the universe of Point Break to The Replacements.
There you go. It would be something. I don't think you need that much.
John Favreau was in that, wasn't he?
Yes. That was in his sort of giant days in terms of like he was all built and working out. He came around. That's his second football film, of course.
Directing stuff.
Yeah, he went on to directing things, a lot of stuff, obviously. But he was acting in.
Because he did Iron Man, right?
Yeah.
Was that him?
Okay. He's now the director of or the broader planner of a bunch of the Marvel films. I think he's doing Tarzan next. But no, he was good in that. He was, you know, again, you could have just sort of ridiculous characters playing stuff. You had a nice Welsh kicker, because why not? Oh, yeah. Who smoked when he was on the field?
Real skinny dude.
Yeah.
Oh, he was in that.
Ole, 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 ole.
Romantic comedy with that British actor. Never mind, I can't remember. Notting Hill.
I was thinking of the other football movie, Necessary Roughness, where the kicker was Kathy Ireland.
There you go. That was a classic film.
That's a classic. Yeah, it's a classic film right there.
No, it was fantastic. I enjoy that film in any ways. You had the dude from Arrested Development.
I only remember one character in that film.
Quantum Leap or Kathy Ireland? You're just stuck on Kathy Ireland?
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay.
Oh, was the Quantum Leap guy in there too?
Scott Bakula was the quarterback.
Oh, I couldn't tell you. I couldn't.
Sinbad was the offensive lineman who went to grad school, and then he was a professor somehow, and then he came back. He was able to play while he was a professor. I don't know that that's NCAA eligible, but... he still had a year of eligibility left. It violates the basic understanding of NCAA eligibility. You can't just like take 15 years off and then come back. Doesn't work that way. But
why not?
Why not? It's all right. It's good.
I was only aware of one character in the movie. Didn't matter.
Okay.
So
keep going, Steven.
I'm not sure I've started yet. So.
What? We're not done?
I don't know what's happening. I mean, Keanu in that film.
There was a bar.
Yes, there was a bar, there was a cheerleader, it had a little love story going on. He didn't have enough faith in himself, he wasn't a leader, but through his team's able to help pick him
like
up.
The Matrix.
Yeah, something like that. Nope. And then he went through, traveled through time and met Beethoven.
And Socrates. Yes.
Socrates.
Damn my education, I pronounced it right there.
No, you didn't get it right either, man. It's Socrates. It's Socrates. Oh, so
no, it's not an American. It's not.
Well, yes. If you want to speak it in American, then you can get Southern Californian, and you've got a lot of pronunciations here. I'm pretty sure if you actually went down to, I won't even get into this conversation. There's certain places in this country that pronounce things in a way that have no connection to my understanding of the language. But we'll ignore that point.
Yeah, I lived near an Athens one time.
Athens? Oh, that's the best place. I love the Parthenon or whatnot. Parthenon.
Who was the love interest? Yeah. Brooke Langton. I don't even know who that is.
She was a bartender.
Has she ever done anything else?
Melrose Place.
Oh, well.
She was in Swingers.
That's a Favreau connection.
Yeah. She's actually been doing lots of stuff. She was in K-9 Adventures, The Legend of Lost Gold.
Is that one movie?
2014. K-9 Adventures.
That would be awesome if that was one movie.
It was one movie, yeah. K-9 Adventures, : Legend of the Lost Gold.
That's actually awesome.
I gotta see that film. Is it streaming? Can you stream it?
I don't know. It came out in 2014, so probably not. She was in Bones, the TV show. Chilly Christmas, The Mentalist, the TV show. The Closer, another TV show. Life, the TV series.
Facts of Life?
Wait a minute. The Adventures of Young Indiana Jones, Winds of Change. Oh, I went right to video. So, yeah, she's been in all kinds of stuff. She was in Weeds and Monk, mostly TV stuff.
Cool. Good for her.
Yeah.
I'm still trying to see if I can stream.
She played Angela Bennett in The Net, the TV series.
Okay, well.
Bringing back The Net again.
I didn't know they made that into a TV series, so.
Oh, God, it was really bad.
It really was worse than the movie?
Infinitely worse.
Wow.
Didn't Sandra Bullock. It was the only good part.
Yeah,
Casey and her friends stumble across an old broken pocket watch. They begin an unexpected journey to unlock the secrets of the legendary Garrison Gold. We got to see this film, guys.
Is this the K-9 movie? No, it sounds like it's for kids, and I hate kids' movies.
It got a 5.3. It's a family film.
Yeah, I hate those things. They're so predictable and boring.
If we're going to go for children's family film, can't we just rewatch The Goonies or something?
Okay, sure. That's like the only children's film I like to watch.
Spy Kids.
No.
What, Goonies?
Yeah, Goonies. Totally a kids movie.
Goonies.
That's kids in it.
Yeah. Brolin's first acting role. Had Sean Astin.
Yeah. Corey Feldman.
Corey Feldman. Yeah, we have one of the Coreys.
Yeah.
You had No Time for Love, Dr. Jones. He was in that.
I love that the pirate's name was One-Eyed Willie. You could not get away with that these days. It would not happen.
Definitely not.
Oh, man.
Oh, boy.
Well, yeah, this woman's done a lot of TV.
Yeah.
It's almost all TV.
Yeah.
Including Baywatch.
Really? I didn't notice that. I guess I didn't scroll down far enough.
1992. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't go anywhere near that far.
So
Terminal Velocity as Jump Junkie number two.
Yeah, I saw that.
I love it when they have these half-ass titles for people's roles.
So Risa Vans, who is the guy who did the, was the kicker from Wells. He actually was in Harry Potter. He was in The Amazing Spider-Man as Kurt Connors, the Lizard. He was in Anonymous, TV show Elementary.
He's great. Yeah, he plays Sherlock's brother.
Yeah, Mycroft.
Mycroft, yeah. Except he wasn't the smarter brother in Elementary.
Well, what was
How can you not be? That's the point of that character.
Yeah, I know, man, but it is what it is.
Okay. What was he in Harry Potter?
Luna Lovegood's father or something.
Okay, I don't know who that is.
Don't remember him at all.
Yeah.
He's a great actor, though. I've seen him in quite a few things, and I really like him. He's always a secondary type character, but he always adds.
So. I also like the name Reese. I loved it spelled that way. I tried to convince my wife to name my child spelled that way, and she had no ability to accept a name that's... does not connect. You know, there's an H in there somehow. And
oh, he was in Mr. Nobody. That's a good movie. Netflix streaming. You should check it out. It's about the basically humans have all become immortal, but this one guy, this Mr. Nobody, decided to live a normal lifespan. And so he's like the first person to die in a really long time. So he's dying in his hospital bed, and it's about his life. It's an interesting movie.
Who plays that role?
Who plays Mr. Nobody? As soon as my internet loads, I'll tell you. Jared Leto. He plays Nemo. Is the character's name.
Oh, okay. Now that I see his face, yeah, I know who that is.
Yeah, it has Diane Kruger in it, who's been in a lot of other things as well. That's a cool movie. It's one that popped up on my Netflix sort of you might be interested in. And so, it was definitely worth seeing.
Now, you know you've damaged your credibility a little bit with saying that these two Matrix sequels were worth watching.
They are worth watching. They're fine.
You like the second trilogy from Star Wars, too, right? And you like that one where they get into... Harrison Ford survives the nuclear blast by being in a refrigerator. It's the best Indiana Jones film for you.
Well, yeah. Well, because the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull is based on historical fact.
Uh-huh.
There were aliens that made those pyramids there in Central America. Yeah. So, and of course it's the best one. I mean, there weren't Nazis, but they certainly were aliens. They actually existed. The Raiders of the Lost Ark, that's all speculative history mostly.
Okay. So, did the Germans actually find the chalice, the cup of Christ, as it were, in as it was depicted in The Last Crusade, or not? Did that actually happen?
No, the aliens made that, and they put it in the little thing that looks like the rock, that looks like a city, and the aliens put it there. Petra.
And then it had the actor that ruins every film. Shia Boof face, whatever the hell his name is.
LaBeouf.
How does that guy get work?
Shia LaBeouf.
Awful.
I don't know.
Steven Spielberg loves him.
He may be the worst actor the world has ever seen.
No hyperbole there at all.
No. Yeah. Okay, so Raiders of the Lost Ark was clearly the best Indiana Jones movie. So, I mean, that's...
Yeah, I think so, too. Yeah,
that's not really a think issue. That's not something people debate.
You know, you could make us...
There are people that do debate that.
Yeah. Last Crusade is pretty good. I liked The Last Crusade.
A lot of people prefer Last Crusade.
Yeah, good movie. Yeah.
I mean, Crusade was fine in its own right, but it wasn't the...
No, I agree.
I agree with you, but I could see people arguing for The Last Crusade because I thought it was pretty good. Because
Connery really pulls off that age difference between him and Harrison Ford.
Was it like 3 years or something? It's not much.
Well, you know, it's... Okay, so it's Raiders, Crusade, Temple of Doom, Crystal Skulls.
Temple of Doom, anything else in the whole world, Wanted Dead or Alive, Crystal Skull.
I think we finally found a film that it beats.
Yes. No, it still was... I told you Wanted Dead or Alive is better than Maximum Overdrive. I'm okay with that.
No way.
Yes.
Maximum Overdrive is way better than Wanted Dead or Alive.
Yeah.
Hated that.
Wanted Dead or Alive just needs to be edited down to be about 5 minutes, and it would be the best film ever.
Why don't you do that, Robert? That could be a homework project. Or our intern can go do that.
Play Bad Harmonica and pull the pin out of Gene Simmons' mouth.
I think our intern should get into this.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow, we could get him to. He's been wanting to do mashups.
That would be a good option.
Sure.
Yeah, him to edit some things.
I'm on board. See it happen.
Yeah. Okay. So.
I've got nothing else.
Way to wrap this up.
I got nothing.
Yeah, I think we run away.
I think I ended a long time ago.
Although I think we should have a secondary argument while still on the stream. I think we should do Bill Murray next.
Bill Murray?
Yeah.
Okay. Sure. That would be an easy one.
So, because I want to do The Man Who Knew Too Little.
Fantastic
film. That was my wife and my first date.
Interesting.
Was it?
Yeah.
Okay. So, there's one for you. Steven, first film you saw with your spouse.
I don't know which one it was, but it was either The Matrix or Titanic. It's one of those two.
Okay.
I don't remember.
I saw half of The Negotiator.
Oh, yeah. And, the other half.
So, no, it wasn't
that. Excellent, man.
You guys do that with everything. 15-year-old. We're going to this.
The Hour of Awesome is a production of Jester Cat Studios. You can see more about this and all the other Jester Cat shows at www.jestercat.com. You can also email the show at hoa@jestercat.com. Catch the show live Sunday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern.
Thursday at 7:30.
JesterCat.com/TV. Follow the show on Twitter at @our_awesome. You can follow Robert at @rsmacy. You can follow Steven at @sehumphrey. And you can follow Chris at @cwculp. And thanks again to Scott Fletcher for the voiceovers. Go to voice.caroworks.com for more about Scott's great voiceover work.